the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Remains standing, and Pastor Aaron Ash will deliver the invocation for us.
Bow our heads and close our eyes for a moment of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray for your blessing upon this evening. Father, we welcome your presence and we seek your guidance, your will, and your favor, Lord. Lord, as we also honor a life and a retirement of Chief Gibson, Father, and his replacement, Father, Lord, I pray for a blessing upon him and his family in this new season of life as well as his replacement. Father, we pray for your blessing upon this entire meeting, Father. We pray that your will be done for your people and your city of Lemoore. And we pray this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and all God's people say.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Be seated. So at this time, Council, we need time to approve that and make these additions to our agenda. Agenda look okay? All right, we proceed as needed. And we do have one item to report out of closed session, so the City Attorney will report that.
Yes, Mayor. Council members, public. The item has to do with the signed letter agreement between the Lemoore Police Officers Association and the Lemoore Sergeants Unit. On a motion by Councilmember Chester, seconded by Councilmember Brown, with a unanimous vote to approve a signed letter agreement regarding changing the overtime structure for the police sergeants and police officers to 80 hours, an 80-hour cycle, and paying them for the last 9 days of September on an overtime basis. December, excuse me.
Thank you. All right, at this point is the opportunity for any members of the public to come forward to speak on items that are not on the agenda tonight. Is there anyone that would like to speak on any item not on the agenda tonight? Seeing none, we will proceed to the next item, which is ceremonial presentation. This is a recognition of retirement for the retirement of Fire Chief John Gibson. So please come forward, John.
So I have a presentation here, a little certificate. We do want to just say on behalf of the City Council and the citizens of Lemoore, thank you for all your dedicated service as a fire chief, as a member of the fire department. Says you've been a member for 33 years.
33 years.
That's an awful lot of time, a lot of dedication, a lot of commitment, and just you know, care for the citizens of Lemoore. So I just want to say thank you and make this presentation to you.
Thank you. Is true to my heart. And in 1921, there was a group of guys kind of like yourselves, seven or eight of them, that came together and sat in front of the city leadership at that time and developed the Lemoore Volunteer Fire Department. They had a tremendous vision that has lasted for 90-some years in the city of Lemoore. And at that time, I believe it was a good fit for the city. A good fit. The guys were here for 95 years. They were, during the war, they were a little skeptical because there was a few of them out on service duty, but they were all here. I also want to thank all of these guys, and this is just a portion of the members that have been involved in the fire department in my 33 years there. Thank you, guys. These 35 guys that are out here right now, I think they are a very, very good fit for the city right now. And with our financial status and everything, I think that these guys will carry the torch excellently. I want to thank Bruce German, David Jones, Dan Hospital for stepping up and continuing on the chief's departments. And I want to thank you, city council, for blessing them. And God bless the Lemoore Volunteer Fire Department. Thank you.
So at this time, we're going to go to department and city manager reports. Oh, I'm sorry. Yep, we're going to do a 15-minute break, ceremonial break, so we can have some cake and ice cream in honor of Chief John Gibson.
Thank you.
All right.
We have a senior advisory committee meeting Thursday at the CMC at 10 a.m. One item we're going to discuss is the senior meal program. City staff has met with KTAAA and the Kings County Commission on Aging. We have some pretty good information to share with the seniors. Also, coming on March 10th is Blue Owl and the Green. This year, we're just doing Blue Owl and the Green on March 10th, and we're going to do a golf tournament, I believe, on September 8th. We're separating out the two events. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up would be Frank Rivera.
I just want to update you on the master plan process. Believe me, staff has been working diligently, collecting data, installing flow meters for collections. On paper, we're about 20 to 25% through the process. I think now that they have a lot of data, it'll go a lot faster. We meet every couple of weeks just to go over the updates. But talk to Eric Saris. He's the senior engineer for Corolla. He plans on doing a more formal update here soon. So he mentioned that I think he promised him that he would update staff more formally. But again, things are going good. It just seems like it's slow, but slow on paper. But there's been a lot done.
Okay, and thanks, Frank. I've got a couple updates. So good evening, Mayor and Council members. On the economic development, we have a lot of things happening, especially over in the industrial park. Virgil Beard is turning and burning on his projects out there, as well as Tom Voorhees on that project. The road's been cut in, as Mark was in, so they're moving forward with that. PG&E is moving along at a rather fast clip out in the industrial park as well. ARCO's been moving ground. They've demolished some buildings already over there, so that's coming real quick. Dollar General is going to start breaking ground any day on their new site over off of Bush and 19th Avenue. And then there's also, we have a map and application in for a development, multifamily development with some commercial over on the corner of Highway 41 and Hanford and Moore Road. So a lot of good things happening. A lot of moving parts, so staff's been real busy, so appreciate all the efforts. Thank you. Oh, sorry, one other thing. On January 25th from 9 to 1 out at the Tachi Palace, State Senator Andy Bidak and Congressman David Valadeo are doing a career and resource expo. So if anybody has wants to participate, if you're hiring or want to go out and check it out or know somebody looking for work, send them out to the Tachi Palace on Thursday, January 25th from 9 to 1. Thank you.
That's it. Check.
Okay, so we will now move to consent calendar. Council, is there any items that you would like pulled from the consent calendar for discussion?
I would like to please remove item 3-12.
Okay, is there any others? I would like to pull item 3-17, and if you don't mind, if we could take that one first, the appointment of fire chief, so our fire chief doesn't have to sit here for the whole thing. We've got other things that we could be doing, so go ahead, this is your item, man. Yeah, sure, we do that. Okay, so other than, we'll go ahead and approve the remainder of the calendar. So do I have a motion to approve our consent calendar other than item 3-12 and 3-17?
How much is approved 3-12, 3-17?
Council, one moment, please. And there's a typo in the report for 3-9 that needs to be corrected.
Okay, so then we will go ahead and do I have a motion to approve the consent calendar other than 3-9, 3-12, and 3-17?
A motion to approve.
Okay. I'll second it.
Motion by Mr. Neal and a second by Mr. Chester. Mr. Neal.
Aye.
Mr. Chester.
Aye.
Mr. Brown.
Aye.
Ms. Blair.
Aye.
And I vote aye.
Aye.
The consent calendar is approved as written, except for those other items that we will pull for further discussion. So 3-1. Okay, so 3-17 is the appointment of fire chief. Mr. Olson.
Good evening, Mayor and Council members. Mr. German, if you would please come front and center, we'd like to introduce you to those that may not know you. So his first call is fire chief. So as the bylaws of the Lamar Volunteer Fire Department, Bruce has met the requirements to be nominated and voted upon by their executive board as the next chief of the Lamar Volunteer Fire Department. So tonight we're just here for council to ratify that vote from the Lamar Volunteer Fire Department and welcome Bruce as our new chief.
Is there any discussion, council? Is there any?
Thank you. Well qualified.
I just like to say congratulations.
Thank you, guys.
Is there any public comment on the matter? Seeing none?
Okay.
We'll bring it back to council. Do I have a motion to approve this item?
A motion to approve.
I'll second.
Okay, so there's a motion by Mr. Neal and a second by Ms. Blair. Mr. Neal?
Aye.
Mr. Chester?
Aye.
Brown?
Aye.
Ms. Blair? And I vote aye as well.
Onboard network and keep doing what we're doing.
All right.
And thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Okay, so 3-9 is the next item on the consent calendar.
Approve 3-9 changes as written.
Second.
So there's a motion by Mr. Brown and a second by Mr. Neal. Mr. Brown.
Aye.
Mr. Neal.
Aye.
Mr. Chester.
Aye.
Blair.
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. So item 3-9 is approved. We'll go ahead and go to item 3-12, which is approval of memorandum of understanding between the City of Lemoore, Kings County Economic Development Corporation for Growth and Development of Industrial Opportunities.
Yes, Mr. Olson. Good evening, Mayor and Council members. As you recall, this MOU was brought before council several months ago, and it had a no vote or no action taken. Since the original bringing of this for consideration for King's EDC, we had Kellen come in and do a presentation. Since then, we've had multiple council members asked to bring it back for reconsideration. So upon the request and talking to council, being there was no action, we are able to bring it back for a consideration and for a vote. So.
I'd like to say something. Because I think we had this discussion just a few months ago, and we had a consensus of the council then that we weren't going to move forward on this, and then it gets put back in as a consent calendar item and has to be pulled. I don't know if it's... We've already had this discussion once before, and I personally don't like the precedent being set that we as a council decide one thing and they can just continue to come in and badger and hopefully get it on a consent calendar and pass the letting notice. But I, for one, am tired of it. They haven't produced in the past. We already made note of that in the last discussion that we had about this, and we voted no. And I will continue to say, nothing they've said now has shown me that they're going to do anything different than they've done in the past, and we're just burning out.
Well, while I bring this up, Cal EDC came in and did a great presentation, and they worked together with King's EDC, and they worked together with multiple cities. And I think our city is a town of a second chance as well. And not only a second chance, they're willing to go the extra mile, King's EDC. And if they can present what they want to present, they can. And I know they're going to go the extra mile. And what Cal presented, it was phenomenal. It should have been here. So I'm here to push for them to come back and give them a second chance. That's my perception.
What is it that they're going to be doing that is so different than the last time they came and presented to us and said no? I have not heard anything that different.
Well, how EDC works was going to be working with us. And no. They can't work with us without working with King's EDC. And so King's EDC is going to come in, and they like working with King's EDC. So King's EDC and then work hand in hand. And so that's what made me look at King's EDC, and I looked at Cal. And Cal has a great reputation, so I look at their background.
Any other questions? Is there any, I do have one public comment. Ms. Walasher, on this item, do you wish to speak on this? There's a card here, your name on it.
Question mark on it, so. I was hoping that Mr. Lane or Mr. Sally would say something first, and then I would say something, because I really feel like we need to go with him. And I, after the meeting was in October 17th, and I did my due diligence on the 19th, and I called, or I went online, and I went to the California lobbyist page, and Chris Kong and they are not registered lobbyists. They are, and Chuck Jaloyan is not a registered lobbyist. And I feel like $42,000 that we're spending with that company is a waste of money. The EDC had a great presentation. They list all of the things that they've done. And I just feel like we need to go with them. And then I don't know, since Chris Com is not on the agenda, but I did my due diligence, and they are not registered lobbyists, and they are not a registered company with the city or with the state of California.
Thank you so much.
Any other public comment?
I would like to ask a question.
Is there anybody that wants this any other number? I think we'll bring it back to council.
I just want a clarification of that, because that same point was brought up when Chris Palm was in fact in chambers, and if we can find audio on that, did mention that they were lobbyists. And so I feel like that is something that needs to be further into, because by all accounts, they are lobbyists.
I'm requesting the documentation that they are legal lobbyists.
I think we're getting off the subject. We're talking about King's EDC right now, and so let's focus on King's EDC, not Chris Palm so much. Please, thank you.
Yes, thank you. So yeah, that is the matter at hand at this point.
What is the proposal that is so greatly different now with under this new suggestion that is a second chance, if you will, that's somehow going to produce different results than the last time that they were in here, and I mean, in and out. So what is so different now?
Okay, first of all, they've never been in and out. They were in for how many years? I think it was over 35. 45. I think that's right there, self-explanatory. But other than that, we looked and did the background, and sometimes we do make decisions that we just say, oh, I made that decision, why didn't look into it much? And I could take ownership of it. And so I'm the kind of guy that I take ownership of that, and I looked at it again, and I seen what Cal EDC does, working with King's EDC. They do a great job. So I don't want to bring it back to the public, Mayor. Maybe you can.
I didn't actually answer my question.
Okay, what's your question?
What are they proposing to do that's so vastly different?
Well, that's they're out there right now.
I'd like to say something, if I may, or maybe they help out. And because I was the one who brought it up there in the beginning, you know, I asked for it to be voted, you know, brought it up for vote. But and I just want to let you guys know my thoughts is on this. I'm willing to do anything within reason for economic development for our city. Okay, I think that in the past we didn't have as much contract oversight. We have contract oversight on it now. We have a statement of work from King's EDC that's going to state what they're going to do, and they have milestones they have to make. If they don't, then we can adjust accordingly. But some of the things that they can do is make available business loans up to $250,000 per qualified business. I would like for them to be out there beating that drum for us, okay? I believe that there's been one, I know at least one business in the city of Lemoore has benefited from that, okay? And that's just one of the things. Right now, unless other people's got other ideas and ways we can increase we can do better with our economic development and try to get our word out that we're out there. We're going to work our industrial side of the house. I think we need that. I think that it's good for the city of Lemoore and good for the valley. They're going to work on communication with other entities in the valley for us. And once again, I go back to the statement that I think we have the way the contract's written now. I think that it will support itself for, if they, I was going to be right out front, if they don't do a good job, then the contract's going to take care of that too. So I really want to give them a chance and go forth and see what's going to happen. I think they're a professional outfit. I think they're going to, they know what they need to do. So that's my two cents on that.
So they've had 45 years to answer that question and didn't produce anything or drop. And then we voted against them to come back. And now, all of a sudden, because if we want to have more ideas, put out a call to the community and ask for more ideas. But just to roll the dice again on a group that we've already not seeing results from, and it is wholeheartedly.
And I think, I wouldn't say not seeing results from, and I understand where you're coming from, and I respect that. I feel that there was results in the past. I'd like for them to come up and, you know, if they would like to tell us what those results were. But at this point in time, I think they really understand what we want, what we want as a council, what we want as a city. And I think that they'll work good with the people that we have on board for economic development, the chamber, with the other entities. And my thing is in the past, if there was a failure, I think, you know, I mean, we can go back and it's not just all them, it's council. So my thing is, I believe that we have something in the contract that's gonna ask for performance. And if there is no performance per contract, then I think that we as a city, then we can go look at other ways. But I think that, you know, other entities, but I'm willing right now to try this. I think that we need to do everything. We need to look at every avenue we can for economic development. Right now, we're working on an economic development plan. Do we want to stay stagnant, city? Do we want to stay stagnant on the way we are economically? We're going to be here 4 years from now saying the same thing. Now, you know, we need more retail. We need more industrial. Well, what are we doing about it? Well, we bring on King's EDC and we say, hey, you need to follow these. You need to hit these. You've got to hit these milestones. You've got to knock it out of the park. If you don't, they're saying they're going to. Proof's in the pudding. Well, let's try it. Okay. And the city, people, if they don't perform, we'll move another direction. But that's all I have to say.
Yeah, thank you. So, yeah, I said it last time. I think that they are definitely someone that we need on board. I think they've proven themselves. They're a local organization. They also work with the state. I think when Cal EDC came here after that particular vote, I think that enlightened us and even made it more important for us to understand that we need to have a local entity like King's EDC. I also believe that the approach that we are taking is a very solid approach with CRISCOM and EDC, King's EDC, working hand in hand. I think it's going to strengthen us. I think it's going to have a positive effect for us. And I said that last time and I haven't changed. I think that we need them on board. My perception hasn't changed since then.
I just have one last question because I do hope that they will come and answer as well with what they're going to do differently. But
I think you asked them that.
No, I did, and I hope they'll answer that again. But this goes to actually Nathan over here. The new developments that you just listed off, ARCO and Dollar General and everything that's happening down there, how much of that new development was brought forward because of something that came to you?
So, directly, I don't know. I don't know what kind of communications they've had with those cities. So, I don't know. A lot of times with economic development, a seed's planted many years prior and it takes a few years to come to fruition. So, I can't answer that question, Ms. Blair. They're going to have to answer that for you. Because, to my knowledge, they weren't involved in these deals. I do know they were instrumental in Loprieto coming. So,
all of them too, right?
I've heard
that it was more the city managers doing than it was EDC. So we're obviously hearing different input by different community members.
I don't think it could hurt to have an organization like that working on our behalf with their expertise, their knowledge, their respect from the industry. I don't think it would hurt us a bit to have that tool in our toolbox, so to speak.
If it was a tool that actually was sharpened, yeah, that would be helpful. But we've seen 45 years of lackluster performance.
I'd like to add that if we could try the King's EDC for 12 months and have them do the reporting that's in the agenda packet and do the quarterly deliverables and the monthly updates and give them a shot and have them go hand in hand with what we're doing at CRISCOM, we need as much power as we can right now to increase our city's economic development. So, you know, initially and in the past, I thought one way, but right now I think that we need to go forward, give them another shot, and I think they're going to work hard. They've worked with us on the price, and I think it's reasonable. I just like to see the benefits, so give them a year, I say.
Are they going to actually answer any of the questions?
Can you answer questions, please? I guess I don't have any questions. There are some questions that are there.
I'm just here at your disposal. For the record, John Lane, president of Kings County Economic Development Corporation. To clarify a misstatement, we didn't ask to get this back on. My understanding is that the council did. And we're delighted with that. We appreciate the support. As I stated in the previous presentation, there were quite a number of things. All right, we rehash if that's what you'd like, Mr. Mayor.
Sure. Or, yes. Please do. We got a different audience today.
Okay. From a historical standpoint, the city and the EDC have maintained a very, very positive relationship. There have been various times where city managers were more or less involved in that. Typically, that also reflected a member who is a voting member on the EDC board of directors and also attends the executive committee. That was pretty much paralleling the reflection if the city manager was very much involved. The council member typically was very much involved. And during those periods of time, the relationship was very positive. I believe that it was because they were most informed with regard to the activities that were happening. And the city manager was very accurate in terms of characterizing the fact that you never know. I mean, Faraday Future, they were here 3 years ago. Everybody thought the project was dead. Well, obviously it isn't. It takes a long period of time. It's not at all unusual for it to take 2, 3, 4 or more years. The general kind of cycle is that somebody will come in and say, I'm going to build in 6 months, and you just drop everything else and you do what you need to get them the information, and then it goes cold, and then they come back again. I mean, that's just the way it works. It isn't unusual. That's just the way it works. Some of the previous businesses we've been very intimately involved with, and I'll never stand up and tell you that we brought in X, Y, or Z, because it's never us. It's the city being prepared for that. It's the relationships that the city manager and other city staff have with them. We may be the one that actually set up the meeting to initiate the conversation, but I'm not going to say that we brought them in. But some of those historically that we have been intimately involved in have been Luprino Foods West, GUSA, Budget Rent-A-Car, Communication Services for the Deaf, APAC, Western RV's relocation, and assisting in the transformation of SK to OLA. I'm not sure exactly what it is that you would want me to do. The memorandum of understanding was put forward by our office. It's exactly as it was, if I recall, submitted. So those are that's the things that we did quite some time ago to try to quantify. If you're going to say, well, how many businesses are you going to bring in next year? And I have to say, it's dependent upon all of us working as a team. If we're, skipping down that road arm in arm, I think we're going to get a lot done. If I'm fighting you or you're fighting me, then, we're going to spend all of our energy and nobody will know about it, our resources. We've outlined, I think, in the MOU, the deliverables, and those are the kinds of things that we believe are the right strategies for any city to take on. We absolutely continue to feel that that's the right strategy for Lemoore. We would also say that if you're able to do that for $20,000, that's great, and that's wonderful, but that, you need to spread those costs over other cities and county and those sorts of things in order to have the resources to get it done. Because for $20,000, you can't even get administrative assistance for the support on that. And you have an entire array of services that are outlined here, not the least of which is the California Central Valley Economic Development Corporation. That's a budget in addition to our budget of $100,000, where we go out on a routine and regular basis, both in person and electronically, and communicate with site selectors in all the major markets. We've been doing it for, I think that organization's been in existence for probably 30 plus years. I don't recall, I know that I've been there for 41. And the EDC, I've been with the EDC for 20, and it's been around for that long. And the reason I make that point is that over a period of time, you develop sort of a Rolodex, so we have lots of relationships throughout the major site selectors, the major brokerage firms, and that sort of thing. We think that that's the strategy. If there's a different strategy that we jointly come up with, let's do that. We're not here to fight. We're here to work together to help strategize, to identify land that's potentially best developable for industrial use. We're not going to jump in there and get in your way on housing or anything else. We're trying to stay in our own wheelhouse. But that's where we've had success.
If I may ask, because I know we're all going to try to save some time here. The main crux of the question I'm getting to right now, though, I'm hearing that the main hinge, especially from you, Councilmember, is that Cal EDC won't get on board without Kings EDC. Sounds fine. You mentioned the budget. That sounds nice. I saw nothing in what you presented that would be a guarantee that anything that Cal EDC is doing would necessarily come to Lemoore and wouldn't go to Fresno or Hanford or wherever else. I think it's great that they all come on board, absolutely, but there's no guarantee with them coming on board that that's going to do us any good other than us giving you another $20,000 to spend right now that didn't necessarily come back to you. I want to know what guarantee there is that I'm getting something in return that's different than what was proposed before.
No guarantees. What we're guaranteeing is that the activities and the strategies that we believe will result in the best opportunity to attract new business is outlined here, and we're committing to do that for an amount of $20,000. Other than that, nothing has changed. Other than the council members collectively, I guess I don't know how many asked for it to be on the agenda, so we're here in the audience tonight to listen to the conversation and answer any questions.
I think you said it, but I heard nothing changed.
In the past year, did you have, I'm just curious, did you have the aggressive, was you tasked to come to council and chat with council quarterly? Is the MOU the same exact MOU that you had years ago?
The Kings County Economic Development Corporation is a membership organization, so it's really no different than you or I, either as an organization or individually belonging to a Chamber of Commerce or the Economic Development Corporation or anything like that. So typically, I wouldn't think that I would go to my local chamber and say, I want an MOU for what you're going to do. I believe that, just using that example, my personal responsibility, I would feel, would be to understand that organization and have the confidence that they can actually carry out the kinds of things that they want and then pay my dues. And really, that's been the way it's been historically. The MOU is something that that was requested by Mr. Laws, the previous city manager. Certainly, we had no problem with that. We generated it. It just didn't see the light of day during that regime. And, so it's been, dusted off a couple of times.
And in the past years with council, and you talked about there was always a city manager and a council member on your board, like you stated before, too, it has to be, this is a team effort. This isn't one-sided effort. And if the other part of the team doesn't come to the plate, you're kind of just, you got your half wheel. And so, I want to ask the question because he's going to ask you, but yeah, I won't go there. But on that performance, but that's all the question.
We have not to address a question you stated earlier that I didn't get to. Had we come back before the council? And the answer was generally no. And the reason for that is that I had understood that was the reason that the council member was part of the board of directors, so that they could come back and their council comments, share their experience with the remaining members.
And if the council member doesn't come back, I'm just going to be flat out frank with you. If the council member doesn't come back and tell the other council member what's going on, so we're asking that council member, whoever becomes part of this,
right,
and you, to come in so we have two ways to communicate, you know. Maybe the council member, maybe they do not fully understand, but then we have you to come in and give us a briefing.
Sure.
And you know, so forth with the city manager too, so.
I would absolutely stress the fact that it has to be a team effort. If it's not a team effort, then we should probably save the taxpayers' dollars, because I don't want you to spend your money, you know, the two organizations are, you know, it doesn't get anywhere.
Right. And yeah. Thank you.
I have one more question.
Yes, sir.
How many employees does the Primo on West Side
have? I think it's 970 some odd.
How many?
It has a tax base of about 5 million in property tax.
That's jobs, number one. S&K, which is Olam now, how many do they have?
I don't have that number on the top of my head. It goes up dramatically during the season. The last I knew, it was somewhere around 300 and some odd during
Are they still existing?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, that's all I wanted to know.
And what about the spin-off jobs from those? The ag and the dairy and the farmers.
But that's to say that you just said that you can't. Okay, can you tell me point blank that you're responsible for bringing La Prima?
No.
Yeah. Can you figure
out? Were we in both, huh?
So you're not directly responsible for La Prima. You can't say that
it's
you
are,
right? It's a team, I understand that, but to say that we got all of these great jobs because of the King of the Sea, I think is completely disingenuous to the community.
The team. Not any one entity, not the city. Although the city manager, Mr. Froberg at the time, was very creative. It wasn't just the EDC, it wasn't just Edison or PG&E in terms of, you know, bringing power, not having power available. You know, it wasn't just the railroad that they happened to be. I mean, it's all those things coming together so that it's the best location for the business.
And we had a lot of things coming together, like Valdivano and Arco and such, without the King's EDC.
But if I may, too, is that foresight. It's the 20 to 30 year plan down the road, too.
That's right.
It's not just what's here today. And that's what I go back to the economic development plan. I mean, we as a city, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? I mean, I'm looking at, you know, I'm getting a commentary now, so I'll back up.
Well, look at to that point, look at those two very major projects that are going on right now, Faraday Future. So where are the suppliers going to locate? Someplace close to them, right? Why not more? Look at Kelly Slater, a wave company, and World Surf League. Where are the suppliers in terms of, it's a major recreational kind of activity. So where are the folks that are going to do the, I don't know, the sound or the music or the, you know, everything associated with that type of venue, where are they going to be? Well, I mean, city staff is very talented. Do they have the time? I can't answer the question, but I can ask it. Do they have the time to pursue all of the spinoff types of businesses for that? I don't know. If you do and if you can for $20,000, I think you ought to do that. But if you can't, then you might want to look somewhere else. Whether it's the EDC or somewhere else, that's your fault.
I believe that's one of the reasons why we had a change in the job description and a promotion within, not just our interim city manager, but other staff members, in order to focus on economic development. We put additional funds in terms of new job description and new that job description, including economic development. So we put money into that already, and now here as well, because suddenly the money that we spent before wasn't worthwhile. I think her staff is doing a great job.
I think it's worthwhile, but I'm thinking of all hands on deck. You know, let's get aggressive on this. Or in 4 years, I'll be back out in that audience, and I'm going to say, and we're going to say, man, where's our, you know, and I respect what you're saying, and I fully respect, and my thing is we should look at it, you know, open and figure out what's our battle plan. What are we going to do? We're going to stay a second.
Okay, can we? I'm just trying to hold up. Can we get a vote on this?
Yes, let's just vote on it.
So do I have a motion?
I'm going to approve. Right.
There's a motion by Mr. Neal. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, so there's a motion by Mr. Neal and a second by Mr. Chedister. Mr. Neal?
Aye.
Mr. Chedister?
Aye.
Mr. Brown?
Aye.
Mr. Blair?
No.
And I vote aye. Item is passed. Thank you.
Thank you.
And we will now move to public hearing. 4-1 is ordering annexation and inclusion of an additional territory of Zone 7 Public Facilities Maintenance District Number 1 and confirming the diagram and assessment of annual levy for fiscal year 18-19 for BFPD District Number 1, Resolution 2018-03.
Mayor, members of the City Council, on December 5th, 2017, the City Council approved Resolution 21735 to annex a new PFMD, which is Zone 7. And today's meeting is to hold a public hearing. It's our next step. So. And at the end of the public hearing, we are to count ballots. So that's why I'm bringing it before you today.
Are there any questions?
No.
Questions? At this point, open the public hearing. Is there any member of the public that wishes to speak on this agenda item? Seeing none, we'll close the public hearing and go back for discussion to council.
The question I had is, and I think I already know the answer, but the people that's going to be doing the work for this is going to be, because before we had contracted employees doing this work, now we have city employees doing it. I've seen them around town.
Yes,
they're doing a good job.
City hired, yes, 4 full-time employees to do the LMD. Yes.
Okay. The contracted employees are no longer with us, correct?
Not the LMDs, just the PFMD.
That's the PFMD.
Yes.
And is there any, and I'll leave that.
Okay, so can we go ahead and count the votes? Okay, do I have a motion to approve this item?
I'll make a motion to approve item 4-1 as proposed.
A second.
Motion by Mr. Chedister and a second by Mr. Neal. Mr. Chedister?
Aye.
Mr. Neal?
Aye.
Mr. Brown?
Aye.
Ms. Blair?
Aye.
And I vote aye. Motion is passed. Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll go ahead and go to public hearing 4-2. Second hearing is 4-2 for information and public input for moving to voting districts. Mr. Olson.
Good evening again, Mayor and Council members. So this is our second public hearing for consideration of public input for moving to district or to voting district. So we have the National Demographic Corporation, Ms. Shalise Hilton, is here, and she's going to give us a brief
brief update and then show us what the model materials that our residents will be able to use for creating housing.
Thank you, Honorable Mayor and Council Members. It's a pleasure to be here representing the National Demographics Corporation. As your city manager indicated, my name is Shelby Stilton. National Demographics Corporation has been in existence since 1979, and we have represented hundreds of cities, drawn out over 250 maps. Since the California Voting Rights Act, we've represented about 35 cities, but overall, about 170 jurisdictions have moved to voting districts as a result of California Voting Rights Act challenges. So we represent body districts, school districts, special districts, as well as cities. Your last meeting, we discussed the project timeline and just wanted to mention for those who were not present at the last meeting, the city of Lemoore has received a demand letter to switch from an at-large city to a bi-district system. With an at-large system, everyone in the city is able to vote for all five council members. And with a bi-district city, only those that reside within the district can vote for a candidate that resides in that district. So ultimately, the city moves forward. The city will be having five districts, and each will be represented by one council member. The reason why we have such a tight project timeline is because the law changed on January 1st, 2017. What was happening is many cities were receiving these demand letters, or actually just flat out lawsuits, and being forced to pay hundreds of thousands of dollars, sometimes millions of dollars, to defend these lawsuits and ultimately settle and end up with districts and be out of pocket, you know, nearly $1 million for some very small jurisdictions, unfortunately. So the legislature changed the law to protect cities, or to put a cap on the amount that cities could be liable for under a threat of litigation. And that was capped at $30,000. And what the legislature decided was that you would have a certain time frame to act once you received that demand letter. So the city of Lemoore received this demand letter for Christmas. And unfortunately, many jurisdictions received them all during the holidays, which made it very difficult for a lot of cities to comply. So kudos to you for getting this in place so quickly, because you don't want to miss these deadlines. What happens when you miss the deadlines is, you know, sky's the limit as far as professional and legal expenses that could be recouped and will be recouped by a plaintiff. So we have already held the first public hearing last week. That first public hearing was to introduce to the public this concept of moving to buy districts and to solicit input on how these districts are going to be drawn. So tonight we are at the second of those public hearings. We've tried to have two public hearings before you can review any draft maps. So tonight it's really very important for two things to happen. One, for us to make sure that the public is comfortable and is aware enough of their role in participating in this process, and that they're able to participate in this process, and that they realize this process throughout will be completely transparent and participatory as possible. And actually it ends up kind of being a fun activity once you get involved in it. And we have a lot of citizens who really get engaged, and we will see a lot of citizens, because the city of Lemoore has made it a priority to get the public participation. So the city is opting to go with public participation kits so that anyone can do it from their home, participate, and essentially your entire city is part of this committee to draw districts. Every map that is submitted will be considered by the city council. It will not be vetted by the city council or vetted by the staff ahead of time. it will be presented to you as it's submitted to us. So anyone who wants to submit a map is able to do so. We will have it drawn up professionally. It will look like every other map. It will have all the demographic information, just like the maps that NDC will propose. So what happens is after the residents submit their maps, NDC will look at those maps and see what's missing. We'll round out the options so the city council will have all options when they're considering it. So back to the timeline, we are on January 16th, and we are working on getting a website up, and we hope to have it up maybe Friday, but it's more likely going to be Monday. There will be a direct link from your website. It will be called drawlemoore.org. We'll make sure that's on Facebook. We'll make sure it's on all your social media, all the other avenues that you have. And by the way, I was happily greeted by your big message board when I came off the freeway about tonight's public hearing, and I thought that was fantastic. More cities, so that's the first time I've seen that, and wow, I'm sure that really captured some attention. I noticed your Facebook Live has a few more viewers tonight than last week, so it works. And the next week is the first, February 6th is the first time you'll be looking at those draft maps that have been submitted. We'll be talking about those draft maps, hopefully narrowing them down to maps you like, maps that make sense. Maybe you can combine a little bit from this one, a little bit from that one. We'll come back at the next meeting with hopefully a narrowed down list, and we want to select a map that's going to reflect your community. So my job tonight is very important that we focus on getting maps that do reflect your community. And what I need to learn tonight from members of public who speak, from those of you that speak, are what are the communities of interest. As a demographer, we can look at all the statistics, but we don't know your communities. You walk the streets, you know your cities, people live there, they live in their neighborhoods, they take their kids to school, to the parks, they know what defines the community. We need to hear specifically those communities of interest. And on February 20th is when you will be introducing your fourth and fifth public hearing. There's a possibility to combine your fourth and fifth public hearing, and that's why the project timeline gives you that option. And it's good to keep it that way, but March 6th is likely when you're going to be adopting your ordinance that will be, but your final map will need to be, we'll figure it out down February 20th. Then when the election happens, it doesn't happen at the first election, and it's really hard for people to wrap their head around. So it takes 2 years for it to happen. On November 18th, we have two council members whose terms are up this term. Those two will be out of office, and there'll be two districts that will be up for election. And those two members will be elected by their district, only for those who reside in their district to be able to nominate and vote for them. And then by 2020, the remaining three. So say if all council members were drawn into one district, and you all lived in one district, you would all continue to serve the citizens at large. There would be one that would be elected by that district, and there would be another district that would come up, and then you would end up with three council members in one district until it all plays itself out. So there's some considerations that we must take into consideration when we're drawing the boundaries. The first are the federal laws. The federal law requires that each district is population balanced. So this is the total population, being citizens and non-citizens, children, every human being that resides in the city will be included in the population. Federal law requires that we use the 2010 census. So we recognize that your city has changed since 2010, but we're required to use those numbers. So those will be the numbers that we're using to get your equal population. There's another factor that we'll be looking at, and that will be the citizen voting age population. It's important that we do not dilute the power of your minorities to elect a candidate of their choice or to influence an election. So federal laws require that we draw the boundaries in a way that we do not crack that population or pack that population. So for example, if you have a concentration of a Latino community that lives in one area, you cannot divide that into three different districts so that it dilutes their power as a community. Now, if it's a very large concentrated area, you can't, and say it's spread out, you can't draw the district to put every Latino in the city in one district so they have no power or influence in any other district. So that's what it means by packing or cracking. So it's important when we're drawing the maps, we look at the total population to make sure that we're balanced. We're allowed a 10% deviation at most. Then we look at the citizen voting age population, because federal law requires us that if we can get a 50% majority of minority district, we must draw a district that achieves that majority and minority. So the racial gerrymandering is what I talked about. That's the case that decided no racial gerrymandering was a case in North Carolina. And what their congressional district looked like was a 160-mile-long, it looked like a berry mine. So when it went along a freeway, and then it jotted out and grabbed a little berry here, grabbed a little berry of African Americans here, it looks like a giant, it made absolutely no sense at all. So in the end, while you must consider the citizen voting age population and minorities, you also, that cannot be your dominant factor, the predominant factor, it cannot be the only factor. So also, it's very important to consider that in the mix of your communities of interest. So in the end, when you have your boundaries, you're able to explain why the boundary is drawn that way. And there needs to be an explanation that is greater than, that is more than just race-based. The traditional criteria is what we're going to be asking for direction from you tonight on. Are traditional criteria that you want used in your, when we're, you're directing us to draw the few maps that we'll be drawing, but more so when you're directing the public to draw. And we'll talk a little bit more about what your options are on that. So these are the traditional ones that demographers and the jurisdictions use when they're drawing, and they're all spelled out in the California Voting Rights Act. Communities of interest, there's not one single definition of what a community is, which is, it's what you think a community is, or your neighborhood is. We try to keep the district as compact as possible, and they must be contiguous. So you can't have one area here and then a little island over here and so district one. Visible boundaries, if you have canals, railroad tracks, freeways, which I believe you have all of those things, that's also something you may want to consider. And then respect for the voters' wishes. And what that is if it makes sense to avoid head-to-head contests, we as demographers will draw that, but avoids head-to-head contests. And typically the knee-jerk reaction is, oh, that's to protect incumbents, but it's really to protect the wishes of the voters. We don't want a demographer's pen deciding if a council member has earned re-election, not if the voters feel decide if a council member has earned re-election. The reason why we lay out potential future growth is because you'll be seeing me again in 2021. Because we need to do this again after the census, we'll be doing it every 10 years. So to take into account future growth does not make sense. It is not possible to do with your shortened time frame. This is a short demographic summary that will be provided to you for each map that is drawn for each district. In addition to the data that is here, we'll also be including information on things such as household income, whether they are owner-occupied properties, the percentage of renters, the percentage of English spoken at home, all various different categories that divide the communities. And I can show you a sample of that if we have time tonight, or I can show you a resource you can get to that. The total... I know that Mr. Olson went over this with you at the last meeting for those who are newly listening to the audio of this and unable to see this presentation. I'll just give you a quick breakdown. The total population, and again, these are from the 2010 census, is 24,531. 40% of those are Latino, 41% non-Hispanic white, 7% Black African American, 1% Native American, 10% Asian American, and that gives you a pretty good rundown of your ethnic profile for the city. The citizen voting age population, and that's what you'll get many of your minority groups really will be focused on, the citizen voting age population, trying to build the strength and get a strong district for themselves. 33% Latino, and if you're Asian, it's a fraction of 10%. The map that I'm showing right now shows your concentration, and this is based on the citizen voting age population. So this is what the courts will look at after you've drawn the map. So once you have moved from at large to by district, you are no longer under the threat of the California Voting Rights Act. So once you are no longer an at-large electoral system, you cannot violate the California Voting Rights Act. But now all eyes will turn to your compliance on the Federal Voting Rights Act. So that's why you hire a demographer, to make sure that you are meeting the Federal Voting Rights Act. And that law is continually changing with the Supreme Court justice decisions, and keep abreast of all of that. But it's very important, as I said, back to not diluting the strength of your minority concentrated neighborhoods. So, and it's not as simple as looking at this color-coded map. However, this does give us an indication of where your concentrated areas are for your Latino population. So the red areas represent that 75% of that area, and this is defined by census block. So sometimes you see a large red area, maybe two or three or four census blocks together, or if it's not a very populated area, it can be a very large census block. The federal government draws those census blocks. My hunch is that green area below that we see right here is not heavily populated. So it may indicate that 50% Latinos are in that area, but they may not have a really dense population in that area. More towards your Heritage Park area is where your higher concentration of Latinos are. As far as your Asian Americans, they're very much spread out through the city. It would be highly unlikely to be able to draw a district that would have majority of Latinos in that district, Asian Americans in that district. So again, tonight, I know many people can be frustrated with this process, and you know, comments were made at the last meeting that you have a history of diversity, you have, and that's reflected in those that have served on your council. And a judge may agree with you, but the judge has to go by the law. And that won't be taken into consideration. The size of your city, we represented jurisdictions of 250 people total in the jurisdiction. change when everyone seemingly is satisfied with the representation. So while we understand that frustration, we do want to hear from you and your communities of interest. It's going to help us greatly when we are looking at maps. So we'll be asking you to consider what are your communities of interest. If you can hear some tonight, do people's comments, your comments, I'll be taking notes. We'll be making sure that we take those into consideration when we draw the draft maps. Some of those could be, you know, school attendance zones. Things on here, such as the highway, what we talked about, the freeway areas or parks or neighborhoods or landmarks, or even groups of people that have come together on various issues and maybe kind of formed an alliance together based on an issue and they consider themselves to be part of the community. Or if they have similar language that they speak in that particular community. Shared demographics, that's going to, I always recall one speaker at one of the meetings that said she was so grateful for districts because she came from a very poor area and she could never imagine herself running for council and knocking on the doors of these large mansions on the hill. So other things to consider are also the demographic characteristics, the characteristics. So there are many things to consider when you're defining your communities of interest. And when we have the demographic data for each of the maps by district, you'll be able to see the percentage of the household income and English spoken at home, those type of things that help provide communities of interest. So we do want to be here for that. Also, there are cases where you may want to have more than one representative, more than one council member representing the community. For example, I live in a retirement community, and we have 1,500 homes in that retirement community. Well, I live on the north side of that community, and it could be that we have a council member who represents the north half, and a council member who represents the south half, and that's great for us, because then we have two people we can call and say, hey, this is not going to be good for my fellow community. We want to change. So there may be cases like that, or there could be cases where you have an economic area, like a downtown and revitalization area, and you want to have as many council members touch that area as possible. So you're not stuck to just doing blocks and fitting the total population. We really want you to think about your community, what makes them a community. I'm going to go backwards here. I'll show you some examples of what that could look like. So these two first maps are fairly straightforward maps that you'll be seeing. These we've considered to be very traditional, compact districts. None of them are perfect blocks. They can't be because we're taking into consideration also getting the majority minority district and also population. So you have a whole entire area of the southern part of your city is not heavily populated. So that will be seen on maps, it will look like a big district, but it will be the same population. The one over on the right, this is what your maps, this is a better representation of what your final maps look like. And so every map that's submitted, whether it's submitted to us on a cocktail napkin or you've used our fancy online tool, it will all draw them up so they look the same. And they'll look very similar to the one on the right. This next slide has a little bit of creativity there. So on your bottom left is Pasadena, and we all just watched the Rose Parade, Colorado Boulevard. Colorado Boulevard was really suffering at the time when they were drawing these maps. So they decided it was very important that each district had a portion of Colorado Boulevard, and many will say that that served them well, and definitely there's some turnaround in some of those economic areas. So one of the criteria that the city council at the time set for Pasadena is we want as many districts to touch Colorado Boulevard as possible. Central Unified School District is outside of Fresno. What they wanted to do is have each of their trustee areas touch part of the urban area and the rural area. So they wanted to put a little bit of country and a little bit of rock and roll. They also wanted to make sure that trustees represented two school attendance zones. So So there was, those were the criteria. They said we want this, and that's why the map looks a little funny when you see the different colors all kind of touching, going sideways, the rural areas, and that's why you see the urban areas. South Pasadena directed that they wanted a mix of neighborhoods for each council member. So we had the higher economic area, I believe is in the northern area, and the lesser. So there's, they would have basically each, they do draw vertical lines, and we're seeing a lot of this now. Vertical lines so that they have a good cross-section for each of the, you can see it wasn't possible to go over on this side to reach the majority-minority area, but that's the general pattern that we see here in vertical lines. So, we, like I said, we offer tools, various levels of ability for our residents to be able to submit one of these, and I realize this is not your city, but we will have a more specific plan. It's just a paper map. So you can take this paper map, and it's available on the web, on drawthemoor.org. And you can draw this map, just take either a colored pencil or heavily outlined boundaries. And those numbers that you see in the middle here show population of this various census tract. So actually, these are population groups. They aren't exactly census tracts. So each population unit, so you can do the map in your head and come up with a pretty population balanced district by district. And then put your name on it and submit it. It can be as simple as that. Also along with this can be is an Excel sheet that you can do the math for you to see how balanced, and it will show the demographics to see if you've reached the majority Latino district. Sorry. Then we have our online tool. It's the best tool that's available, but it is a little bit cumbersome because it was drawn several years ago. Anyway, I mean, it was created several years ago. But it is best available once you get the hang of it. It actually works, but what it actually works really well, and find people submitting three or four maps. So what it is you go into your online tool, the map of the city will come up, and you select how I want to choose my map. So you can basically just say, okay, well, this one, just take your cursor, draw a little circle, say, put that in district one. Draw another little circle or whatever, you know, right here you can choose how you want to draw. I'll draw a perfectly round circle for you, or a polygon, or whatever you need. And then district two. And then we'll do a snapshot here down below is how you're doing with your population ballots. Okay, once you have it, you can submit. You can share that with others. So online, when the next person logs in, if you shared your map, they can look at it and say, yeah, I like that map, but I want this line to go a little bit this way, and they can change it as soon as it's there. So once you get a few maps up there, you'll see that continue to grow fast, because people can just take one map and say, I like everything about it, but I don't like this part, and they can change it. So this comes to the end of my presentation. If there's a desire to see a working website, it would be what your website looks like. We can show it to you now, or I can tell you, draw LF, that stands for Lake Forest, .org, is a fun one to play with, because they are completed the process, but it shows you. It's draw LF .org. The LF stands for Lake Forest. So drawlf.org. And then we'll have things that very similar to what the Moore's website will look like. And it will have all explanations of how all these different ways that you can draw a map. It will have full demographic sheets of your entire population as it exists today. And then once maps start to get submitted to us, we'll prepare them professionally, and I'll have them up there with the demographic data for each map. Okay? So that concludes my formal presentation, unless you want me to show you that website quickly, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Question. on the maps that are submitted, you say people put the names on. Is those names, I mean, are those anonymous when they're presented to us? Or, I mean, is the public going to know that John Smith or Jane Doe submitted this map? You know what I'm saying?
Yes, I do. So when it's on the website, we'll assign the number to it.
Okay.
So when it's submitted, it will say map 101.
And that's the way it would be presented to us.
Mm-hmm.
So it's we don't know, and there's no favoritism or anything, per se.
Right. If you want to keep it completely anonymous, we can. It usually ends up being a hybrid of both. Because some people will say, wait a minute, I can't tell which one is my map. And so we keep a list of the names. And then sometimes it just starts to become easier, and so people are comfortable with. And sometimes we can put map 101 and we put in parentheses, sign the name, just because people are like, well, whose is this map? So it just depends on how you want to deal with it. Usually, typically what we see is we start with just, we just put the number. We do keep a list because sometimes someone will call and say, hey, I don't see my map at all. And we'll say, well, this is map 108. And that's incorrect how I thought I submitted it. So that
I kind of like that, where it's, you know, it's kind of my initial thoughts is it's where it's, you know,
it is
anonymous. And so there isn't, oh, that, you know, then there could be some bias in it or something. Hey, watch, you know, friend, buddy.
Right, that's a good point. I do want to point out that when you log on to the online interactive tool, it asks for your email address. It doesn't verify that email address. We have that feature taken off. In fact, I just caught on the website where it says, you'll receive that, when you first go on the interactive tool, you have to sign up for it with an email address. It doesn't need to be a valid email address. If you want to remain completely anonymous, you can. Then you'll be able to continue to log in. The city that I worked for, I'm a retired city clerk, when we went through the process, everyone submitted name. It was in one park, so they had blueberry pie, Snoopy, all the figures from the Parks Museum. Those were the names of our maps. And then it kind of got ridiculous because we're talking about, you know, well, I like the Hello Kitty map, but I don't like the Johnny Depp map. And then we moved to colors. So after the council narrowed it down to six, we moved to colors. Yeah, so typically that's how we'll start, and we'll just be presenting them away. And we'll keep an ongoing list just for those.
I have a question, just because this is a question that I've actually been asked twice now by people who know about the process. The question has to do with the mapping of the school districts, and overwhelmingly I get asked the question, is it going to be the same map? I know the answer to that. But my question is, on your draw tool, which I'm on right now, which is really cool, by the way, will the district of the school districts be like, can you overlay that or have a link to that, perhaps the city can link to that? Because that does seem to be a recurring question, and I'd like to be able to have an easy answer for people.
So the answer is yes. There's another tool that is not detected in my slides. And what that is in fact, what it is it shows, once we have the maps all prepared, it will have those maps listed on there, and you can do different views of all the streets, just like Google Maps.
Right.
Okay, or you can do streets, you can do satellite views, so you can see, you know, the actual, where the business mountains are. But we can create, and I'll make note of it, if you want to click on there and show the school boundaries. Do you have only one school district?
How many?
You
have multiple districts.
Multiple, yeah. It gets a little
different. We have them outside the city limit, too.
Right. Yeah, yeah. But we can overlay the school boundaries.
That just kind of seems to be a common question.
Yeah.
You can answer that quickly.
So when someone's drawing, you can go online onto that tool and see where we can make that be one of the overlays for that option.
Right. But this, if anybody has a chance to check out the... it is actually pretty intuitive. I think it's wonderful because... just like Google Maps, you can see where everything's drawn out, and you can pull up different ones that other people have suggested. Is this one you're working on right now, and it hasn't been finally approved? Is that what this is?
It shows on the map.
On the Lake Forest one.
Not my client, so yeah.
With a bunch of draft maps on it?
Yeah. You'll see that some of these that started the process before January 1st, they had a longer time to do it all. You're having to do in 90 days what cities take a year to do. So this public participation tool that you purchased is wonderful because this takes the place of being able to hold those neighborhood and community meetings where everyone gets together and draw a map. Because you just don't have time to do all the community forums and everything that you normally do.
I think it's really top notch. Thank you.
Just to confirm too, as was said at the last meeting, that you would not know where the council members live. So that way you don't, you know, we're not gonna, I mean, I don't think none of us want that either. We don't, you know, we want to make sure it's fair, you know. You know, you're not gonna know where the council members live, so you're not gonna say, okay, council member lives here, let's split it up and that's it. You see, so that's not gonna influence your decision or the decision for the map that you guys are gonna create.
What typically happens is when we are drawing maps, you'll be hearing from the public. In many cases, they'll want to know where the council members live. So I've had a few jurisdictions where they say, absolutely not, we don't want the demographer to know. That's usually the exception. So why that's not our guiding factor, okay. It does come into play when we're doing sequencing for the districts. So what happens is when we draw, once we present the maps, we're going to also have to propose what assigned election year to each district. So if we have a map and we have three council members end up in one district, we need to determine an election cycle for that district. So normally, as NDC, it's your decision of what the election cycle would be. But normally, we would propose that the election cycle for that district be the same as the majority of the incumbents that reside in that. So if you have two who are up in 2020, one who's up in 2018, we would propose that election district be assigned in 2020.
The question I have is, Mayor and I, our term would be up this year. Mm-hmm. What if we end up in the same district? How would you handle that?
That happens all the time. So then there would be, say you both end up in District 1. So on the ballot would be District 1 and then one other district. And it would likely be the district that didn't have a council member residing in that.
Okay. So to answer that, the two council members would have to compete in the one district that they're assigned in during that proposed cycle year. And somebody new within that district boundary in the unrepresented district would then have an election according to whatever cycle has been decided on.
That's correct.
Any other questions? Thank you.
I sleep over my friend's house all the time, but I use that.
So right now we'll do the public hearing first. Okay. So at this time, we'll go ahead and open the public hearing. Anyone that would like to come forward and speak on this agenda item, please come forward.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, council members. My name is Todd Barlow. I'm a local. I'm a very local, back to my great grandparents. And I love this city, and I want to thank you for the work that you're doing. And I'm here to speak on behalf of my relatives who still live in Lemoore because I live in Canada. And I cannot wait to go to my father's house and draw the map of Lemoore with him. He is going to love it. He's 77 years old. He's a little bit mobile. We're going to have some fun with this. It's going to be a great idea. That would be a great decision by this council to allow the public to have that tool to use. Let me tell you a bit about my background. I'm the superintendent of Kit Carson School. 72 square miles or more cows than people. And It's the school you see when you're driving to Visalia, and you look out to the left, and it's red, white, and blue. There's a sign out there on 198, and it's kind of the last school district you get to before you get out of Kings County going that way. All school districts faced in Kings County were faced with the same district representative area issue several years ago, 5 or 6 years ago. The County Office of Education really impressed on us the importance of one thing. On one hand, it was, you want to make sure and get to the core of the issue, which is representational equity. And that is a very important issue for everybody. And really, how they did it was they think about this council 10 or 20 years down the road. And 10 or 20 years down the road, none of us are, well, some of you might still be sitting where you are, but the idea is that the entire population has a chance to be representing their own community. And so that's a very important point. The other part was, let's not get sued, which was a very important point too. So I do not think that this council or any city will encounter the problems that my school district has. And I just wanted to give some perspective. What happened when we went into district areas is we got what I call the $10,000 picture. And the $10,000 picture is a map of our district that costs about $10,000 to make. And that was the going rate at that point, it's probably more for city, and it's probably more nowadays. But you have plenty of wall space here to put up your $10,000 picture. But it'll be a representation of what your community is and what this council is. The problem we're having is we have vacant board member areas. I do not think that will happen in the city because the population is higher and the buy-in for city council members is greater. But population shifts, population growth, like this lady mentioned, I'm sorry. Shalise mentioned, population growth will occur. In my district, we had population shrinkage thanks to high-speed rail, which took out a row or two of houses all the way through. And so in 2020, when we get our new $10,000 picture, we're going to have to redraw our district based on the population diminishing in some of the areas. I don't think that's going to happen in Lamar. I don't think there's going to be a problem with representation. So what I do want to say is that with the census coming up, even though you have to plan for 2010, you have to think about 2020. And with this tool that you're giving the citizens, that will help out. And I would just like to offer my own input as to what the communities of interest are. I love the ideas about the schools being the hub of our communities. But as representatives, I don't think we can separate into individual school districts. We can't have a Meadow Lane council member and a Lamar Elementary council member and a PW Meatball council member. The idea of council members representing several schools, and if possible, all schools, but that would be a crazy looking map, would be a good one. And I also would think the other community of interest is local businesses. There are businesses that are scattered all around Kings County, and so the input I would give is just that. Those are our two very important communities of interest, schools and local businesses. And that's the input I have for today. So thank you very much for your time, and thank you for all the work that you're doing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other public comment?
Good evening, my name is Christopher Cook, and I do have a couple of questions regarding current events on this matter as well. You said that you would be able to find out people's median income and other census statistics, but is there a way when the maps get drawn to be equal? What I'm referring to is the cases being reviewed by the Supreme Court on the partisan gerrymandering. Is political party going to be available for statistical purposes?
Do you
want
me to answer now?
Yes.
No.
Okay.
Yes.
so that won't be, that's not even a possibility to...
We have voter registration included as far as those who are registered to vote and those who are not. But we do not have...
Party information.
Right.
Okay, and kind of going on what the previous speaker asked, how often are these districts going to have to, how many 10,000 pictures are you going to have to pay for?
Every time there's a new census.
Every 10 years, I guess, but when we start off now, it's going to be, what, 2-3 times until we get the census done?
It's this cycle now because of the adjusted timeline because of the lawsuit. And then the regular census is in 2020, so it'll have to be done during the regular census, and it wouldn't have to be done again for 10 years.
Okay? Right. My understanding. So, she brought some good ideas. My one idea would be to have equal representation in urban as well as rural. And again, she was showing the example of Pasadena, D and 18 would be two primary areas to look into to make sure as much representation, I guess, for the that are different districts touching those areas. Mm-hmm. That's all.
Thank you.
Any
other
comment?
How many 1065 are there anymore? Addressing one issue that he mentioned about whether you would be able to tell if they were Democrat or Republican, these are nonpartisan positions. So in my understanding, that should not even come into play. The other question there, Tom and I would make, would be to the issue of more than one current council member living in the same district. Maybe not the first election in 2018, but certainly in 2020, that could be a distinct possibility. So my question is this. If two or more live in the same district, and of course only one will be elected, the other one has, or others have the choice of running against that or moving to another district. So the question is, when would they have to move? Would they have to move before the election or wait until the election is over and then move? Thank you.
We would have to look up the residency requirements, but you would have to establish residency in a particular district, which I believe requires a 6-month, living in the area for 6 months. Prior to the election, that you'd have to post your papers, which is generally a couple months prior to the election. I think, believe it's in August or something for the November election. So you would have to plan ahead a lot.
Any other public comment? No? Okay, so I'll close the public hearing. Back to council for discussion.
I have a comment. One of our gentlemen that came and spoke, as we mentioned, our discussion of maybe possibly having an overlay of the school districts to overlap, could we also look at the overlay of businesses to overlap, if nothing else, internally? Just so we have a sense of, I think it is important that council members represent various businesses throughout the city, and since it's already been brought up by the public as well, is there a way to also incorporate that as we're looking at the map?
You're just saying to highlight business.
Just as you highlighted the demographics of the Latino population and the Asian American population in earlier maps, is there a way to also highlight populations of businesses in town?
So to answer that question, we find that the tool that the best tool for that is the satellite. So, am I looking at this? I step over to the computer here. We're on draw the screen here, and when you see your own city, it'll just so much easier to understand. Basically, your black and white map that is actually hanging on the wall to the right of this, you can see it will be very similar. You'll have these colored district overlays. You will be able to see, you can identify what the industrial areas, what your commercial areas, what the farmland areas are. And this, on this particular one, is where we would also have the option for you to rebuild where the school zones are. And then what I'm showing on the right-hand side are, those are all the various maps that were submitted by different people. So I could click on whatever map I wanted to show, and it would show you, you know, a different map. So when, once these maps get submitted, then you can look at it and say, oh, I kind of like that, how that one's drawn. And you can take this tool, this information that you want, and you can go on the interactive tool where you click and add by census block. Also, you can bring up on here the map that I showed you in paper form that shows the population units. So you can say, oh, what if I add this area? How much population is it going to have in the district?
So I'm getting distracted by this.
Okay, so we have to take some action on this one. So I'll need a motion and second to instruct staff to move forward with the process.
I'll make the motion for staff to move forward.
I'll second.
All right, so there's a motion by Ms. Blair and a second by Mr. Chester. Ms. Blair?
Aye.
Mr. Chester?
Aye.
Mr. Brown?
Aye.
Mr. Neal?
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. Thank you. All right, we'll go to the next item. This is Council Action Item, Section 5-1. Hiring of Richard Watson and Gershon for Bond Disclosure Council Services. Ms. Gordon.
Good evening, Mayor and Council members. One of the first things, let me start at the beginning. Back in November, before Thanksgiving, City Council approved the resolution 2017-30 regarding the intention to issue tax-exempt obligations to finance water projects. So basically, you can open the door to consider issuing a water bond. One of the first steps to this, and in keeping us on track, and keeping us doing what we're supposed to be doing, is to hire a bond counsel. So I'm really good with numbers, but I'm not so good with legal stuff. So what she does is she's able to guide us through what we need to, these are the ordinances you need to issue, these are the trust indentures, all of the little details that are not numbers related. And so what the person that I'm suggesting that we hire Richard Watson and Gershon for the Bond Disclosure Council, because I worked with Teresa and on the defeasement of the 2011 RDA bond. And that's difficult even when you know what you're doing. And she knew what she was doing. I mean, but it was my first defeasement that I've ever done. And so she was incredibly helpful and walked me through it. When you go through a bond process, which I've been through before, not as the front line, but kind of as support, just providing all the numbers, you have to have a close relationship with all of your bond team. You have multiple people on your bond team, and so it's important that you understand them, they understand you, they know your strengths and weaknesses, and you know who they are. And we'll be bringing back different people to add to this bond team, and you'll get to approve each one every time. But usually, I work with Teresa really closely for about 2.5 months right when I got here, and so she was incredibly helpful with me. And so when we're doing something this large and this important, I would like to go with somebody that already has a track record with us. And their current price is capped at $87,000. It's $85,000 for the actual work and then $2,000 for any coming up here. And she wanted to come up here and do this presentation, but I'll be honest with you, I'd rather save when she needs to talk about technical stuff. So I said, I think I can handle this. I can talk to you guys about this and let you know what she's doing. I also attached she forwarded me a notice of the work that they've done before, who they are and what they've done before and that sort of thing. And so I attached that for your review also. So I'm asking for approval for the city manager to sign an agreement with this, with her and the, her company, so that she can be our bond disclosure counsel. Any questions, comments?
I have a question, if
sure.
I may. The bond is for water.
Yes, sir.
Now, is that for storm, sewer, and domestic, or is
no,
that
just water? Just water.
Just domestic water.
Yes.
Drinking water.
Drinking water. Yes, exactly. It's not for stormwater or sewer.
Okay, so just for the domestic utility.
Yeah, this would be the bond measures that we passed the 218 hearing on, and if memory serves right, it was about $18 million for water quality, which is the TK Gen compliance, which is in front of the state right now. We're expecting their report back in 2 weeks. And then the additional is infrastructure,
okay.
Some additional wells
and whatnot. And another question is the bond company, they don't really work on anything. I know because there's ongoing possibilities of grants. So the bond team, they don't work with grant, or do they do any suggestion with grant, or are we going another avenue for grants, or
no,
we rent it out to where we don't get anything?
I wish. I would love that.
I know you guys are keep beating the table.
We keep doing that, and she keeps her ear to the ground. I mean, that's not where they're at. That's not their focus.
That's not their forte.
But she is, I trust this firm, and I wouldn't believe that she would say, you need to do this if there's something out there.
Oh, no. And I should understand that we're going
but
with
yes,
the firm. And I believe we need it, but I just, I know you guys are.
Yes.
You know, and I appreciate what you do. Keep tapping the door, knocking on the door. I don't care if it's FIDAC's office or Validate. I don't care who it is. We try to get, we can get a dollar from them to get a dollar.
That's right.
Yeah. So
that's right.
And that's on.
Yes, what does that TTHM stand for?
Oh, goodness, I had this in my other report.
I'm going to try trihalomethanes. It's basically a secondary byproduct of ammonia reacting with chlorine. We are out of compliance for that.
Currently. Okay. And that is $80,000?
No, just her, just the agreement with the bond attorney. Is $85,000. It's capped at $85,000. The TTHM, I believe, was $18 million to fix it. Am I correct, Nathan, on that?
$18 million.
Yes.
The TTHM, but then there was additional.
Yeah, there's additional projects.
Wells and some
yes.
New transmission lines.
Yes.
And storage.
And this is a cap, though. This does not necessarily mean it will go to $85,000. This is just what we're capping it in case of additional cost down the road. But we're not immediately assuming that that's
correct.
Cost.
I mean, I didn't want her to come up here today, so I'm pitching the pennies every place I can. Yes.
Not for $3.95 an hour.
No.
Not about there either.
I'm in the wrong business, huh?
Any other questions?
I'll make a motion to approve.
Well, we got. Is there any public comment on this matter?
Just one question, where is this $85,000 coming from? Is it coming from the general fund or is it coming out of the bond? Thank you.
That's an excellent question. It is actually coming out of the bond. It's included in that total price that I told you that we would go out to finance. We roll it all in together and it's included in that.
Any other questions, comments?
And the terms of the bond will be decided.
Yes. All the only thing that you've told me now is that we agree to let you look into issuing a bond. And then I have to bring everything back every time.
And that will be okay.
Yes.
And that will be all up for the public to hear.
Yes, of course. Yes.
No more public comment. Bring it back. Council for a vote.
I just wanted to say one thing to Heather. I just want to say thank you for all the work that you're doing. And it's really amazing to have a staff member to say, you know, this is something I really need expertise on. And to step out of your comfort zone and to do that, I think is really amazing. And I just want to say, I want to commend you on that. Because I know that's not easy to do.
But I'm really good at numbers, though.
I agree. And with that, I'll make the motion to approve item 5-1 as proposed.
Second.
Okay, motion by Mr. Cheddar, and second by Mr. Blair. Mr. Cheddar.
Chester?
Aye.
Kamara?
Nope.
I mean Brown, I'm sorry.
I know, we're...
The B's on the end, I'm sorry. Mr. Brown, okay, so Mr. Chester, but aye.
Aye.
Mr. Brown?
Aye.
Blair?
Aye.
Mr. Neal?
Aye.
And I vote aye.
Thank you.
Next item, 5-2, Ceremony Museum, Rural Process Agency.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor and council members. We're bringing this item to you because the Ceremony Museum received a grant for $5,000 to put a mural up in downtown Lemoore, and which is great. They contacted the city to find out what kind of process it has to go through in order to get a mural approved, and looking at our municipal code, we have to go through a major site plan review, which is $3,400. Well, that's going to chew up a lot of $5,000 to receive. So staff internally talked about this and thought, okay, so what goes into a major site plan review? Typically, that's to look at an entire site when you have a vacant piece of land and you're going to put buildings up there and everything. It's really not for reviewing a mural. So I thought, what is this really like? It's more like a sign review or something like that, reviewing art for your community. So we talked about different options, and the main thing that came up was, well, let's just have a mural review. So I put in the staff report some items of what is currently in our municipal code, and it's pointed out as item E, murals, and there's 3 points. We'd like to take a look at this and change the language as a zoning text amendment. And the recommendation then is change the site plan review for mural review to a mural review with $160 review fee, which is equal to a sign review fee, or something other than that, something less, something more if you want. Or waive the fees altogether, because what we want to do is encourage art in the community. It's really beautification. It draws people to the community. You get outsiders that want to come here and review the murals that we have around town. So it's really a good thing to do. So I'd like you to consider that, to review it, changing the process and changing the fee. I do have Linda Lahodney is here. She is with the review. She's with the Ceremony Museum Committee. And if you have any questions about the mural that they're going to propose, she's here to talk about that process. But I think that what I'm here to ask for is a change to the zoning code. And what that process would look like is, you would give staff direction to go ahead and start this change. Then once you come up with some language, we would take it to the Planning Commission for their review. Then after they decide if that's appropriate or with some discussion of it, then after they will make a recommendation to City Council. It would come to City Council as a first reading and then a second reading. And then after a 30-day waiting period, then it would become the new law. So my hope is that you direct staff to make that change, and in the meantime, let us move forward with working with the Ceremony Museum and any other murals that are coming forward, if there's any others, work through those as a type of mural review process, and hold off on charging them any fee until the zoning text amendment takes effect. And then we would charge them whatever it is that you decide is an appropriate fee.
I have a quick question.
Sure.
Have you estimated the cost for staff to do the suggested review?
You know, I don't think
I mean, is it going to take an hour? Or
It shouldn't take that long for staff to review. It's like looking at a sign,
right?
Reviewing a sign. Now, a sign is different because you have dimensions that you have to calculate for the building and how much signage that they can have. A mural, you're really looking at a picture, and I don't think it's up to me.
Well,
or staff. We want.
I still go back. I fully understand, and it's not. It's just for you to process the paperwork.
Correct.
So I mean, we're talking about $160. If it only takes a half hour just to process it before, once it's approved and it does come to council, just to process it for council to look at.
Right.
That's the thing is maybe it's only $80.
Right. It shouldn't take that much time. It would take the time to write a staff report, to bring it to you, to talk about it in a public session.
Okay.
And then
and if, we'd have
if you're talking with it on the first go around, good. Then maybe it's, you know, maybe it's 50 at it. It might take a couple of times coming back to City Council before you all agree on.
And when they do come to council, say if it does get approved, and they do come to council, they're going to come with a rendering, a drawing to say this is what it's going to look like, mm-hmm. and maybe you know a little history behind why they're doing what they're doing or whatever. That's going to be part of the requirement. Or is it just,
I would say a rendering. I know for the Ceremony Museum, they're talking about doing a write-up, a kind of a walking tour. I don't know if it's a walking tour, but a write-up of all of the ones. If you want the code to be changed to say, we would like a brief history to be submitted with.
This beautifies our community, and if this is what our community is saying they want, I understand, you know, there's a fee associated with it, but I'd like a voice from the council saying, we want more of this, and we want artists to come. That's vastly different than inviting businesses to come and try and pitch ideas. You see what I mean?
But at the time, though, would it be up to council? I mean, at the end of the day, it'd be up to council to say if we're going to waive the fee or not.
Right.
I mean, you would charge it. You got it.
Or write the code in such a way that they could do it.
Yeah, it's
individual. A byline in their budget to adjust for nonprofits that come and seek something. Perhaps when we look at our next budget review, we can item that allots for X amount of dollars for nonprofit groups that come forward, whether it be for murals, when the NAACP came forward, for usage of facilities, make that part of a nonprofit byline to go into that. Is that possible to do in our next budget?
Well, if you're going to, and you're talking about nonprofits using city facilities, I'd like maybe we need to chat about that again and bring it back so we understand what we agreed to back months ago on nonprofits in our resolution where we came to a determination on how nonprofits would use city facilities. Because I think there's still some question in there on really what we're to be doing. Because I think there's a sliding fee, a sliding scale. I know Jason will probably have that answer, but before we go any further, because now we're talking about kind of morphing over to nonprofits.
I'm trying to remember. So what we did, the service clubs who gave back to the city historically, I may not know verbatim, but we were giving them three special events per year for free because of their historical contribution over the years. And in addition to that, we gave them a free meeting space to meet. So, and there is a sliding scale for City of Lemoore nonprofits.
Okay. So we already have something in place for that, which is good. I with the council member Blair, you know, we can look at the cost and the fees. I don't want to waive them. I don't want to waive them outright. I mean, it's situational. So. Thank you.
Thank you.
That really.
One thought that just came to mind is that we don't get a lot of requests for murals, so we're not talking a lot of money. That's just what I want to throw out there.
I fully understand that. We've got to have some oversight on them, you know. I agree with the mayor, you know, it's the taxpayers' dollars, it's not my dollars. I mean, you know, and so we need to look at that. You know, what it is going to cost the city. You know, it's going to cost $80. You know, that's something. You know, we just dropped it $80, you know, instead of it, you know, we're going to reduce $160. We don't know it, you know. So
right.
That'd be nice when you bring that back, you know, to have that costing, you know, pr-
approximate.
That's what we'll do. We'll move forward with some zoning text amendment to planning commission, and we'll bring it back for the first reading to council. We'll have some recommended fee structure in there.
And I like this because this is streamlining things. This is getting stuff in and out the door fast.
Correct.
And I'm looking forward to this happening in other areas. I mean, whatever we can do, I mean, this is a start, you know, for businesses, for other areas to come in and, you know, get things done quick. Other municipalities are doing it, you know, and it's working, so thank you.
Well, if we change the ordinance, can we allow the language to state then that somebody could come forward on an individual basis and ask for a fee reduction or a complete fee removal altogether? Can we have it built in such a way, as you said, it's not like we get a lot of these requests, so that individual people could come, if it's only like once a year somebody's asking, that's different than a set schedule.
Well, I go back on the same content, not to be argumentative, but my thing is we were discussing it. We don't know what the future's going to bring. I can't sit here and say that we're only going to have one per year. You know, tomorrow we might have two. You know, I don't know. So my thing is at the end of the day, we just need to make sure our city, our taxpayers' dollars, is accounted for properly. So.
Well, my suggestion would be, could we change the recommendation instead of reducing it to 160, why don't we just say reduce the fee to cover staff's time?
Like that.
And not say or waive, but just reduce the staff time. And then you spend an hour on it, it's done. Okay. Can we do that or not?
Council, you can give direction, but you cannot make that action tonight. You have to have public hearings before you can make such an action.
My recommendation. I like the recommendation.
So do we need to vote on that or just approve that direction then? Or do we need to take a vote?
You have to talk to me. I need to send it to the public first.
That's right. So any public comment on this?
I've never seen that one.
I'll be really quick. I know you guys are miserable. My name is Linda Wahadney. My address is 15911 16th Road, Lemoore. I'm the president of the Ceremony Museum Board. And so I just have a couple of things. I want to give you approval at all of the murals, any of the existing murals, with the exception of maybe the Lemoore Food Locker, because I don't know about that one. But They just happened. And so when I sent Judy an email and because I don't want to just assume that things just stay the same, because that was years ago. And she said, no, we have this ordinance. And so I thought, okay. And I really agree with the fact that you should approve every mural. But I also agree with, you know, we need to streamline that process. I have a suggestion just for to throw into the mix on this. We could actually reestablish a chamber committee that's a mural committee. And it could be Chamber of Commerce, just separate, you know. And then let that mural committee establish draft some guidelines for future murals that then could come to you. I'm trying to eliminate as much of Judy's time as possible, and our time is free. We're all just volunteers, so we're good with that. We could draft some guidelines. Judy could put it on the agenda. It could come back to you to approve the basic guidelines for murals. The murals that we did in the past were all of a historic nature. They were supposed to reflect the history as well as the cultural diversity of our community and also our industrial, like the mural that's on the side of Locrino. It's the history of the whole cheese making process that all happened here in Lemoore. Every mural that was done in some way captured the history and the culture of the area. And that's what this one that we're proposing to do see that continue, so that murals are appropriate for our area. They're some way reflect our personality as a community. Also, the mural committee could then assist and encourage future mural projects. And the murals, the idea that anybody's going to come in and just put a mural on a building is probably not going to happen, because murals are generally very expensive. Somebody has to pay for them. Plus, the building owner has to agree to having a mural either painted on their building or hung panels on their building. So if you think that having such a committee is a good idea, I would be willing to pursue that and recruit people to be on a committee, and I would be willing to serve on such a board. So if I can help with that in any way, I'd be more than happy to do that.
Can I ask a quick question? Because that mural committee, was it appointed like the... It'd be like downtown merchants, so it'd be appointed by council or just
It was actually a chamber. The downtown revitalization committee was actually a chamber of commerce committee.
Okay.
And the mural committee was just a subcommittee.
Okay.
We appointed ourselves. We took the direct approach. Let's just do it. So anyway, thank you for your time and look forward to working with you. And come and visit the museum.
Yes.
If you've never been in the museum, you need to do that. Every Sunday afternoon, noon to 3.
Good place.
We're very gobbled.
Three.
Need to put something in the budget to buy me a remote microphone so I can listen. If you're truly interested in art, then, and from my point of view, it makes no difference if it's a nonprofit or a business doing it. Why are you going to charge a business for something that's going to beautify the city? That was just a blank wall over there when I moved into Lamar. That's a great addition. Why shouldn't you have to pay a big fee when you just want to approve a mural? You know, it could be a really simple process. I'm sorry, Mr. Powell, I got to pick on you a little bit.
That's okay.
But I'm sorry when you said that it's our money and not your money. I was hoping that you were also a taxpayer.
I am. Yeah, but I represent you.
Actually, to that point, I just want to bring up, when I was talking about businesses, I didn't mean small businesses who want to add a mural to the side. I meant opening thinking of the future and not opening a door up to somehow have. There are businesses who specialize in pumping out murals, and I didn't want to be a target for, oh, look, here's a place that we can, you know, easily spend with some people. So I was just saying in terms of there's a difference between that and, you know, a college kid who's an artist or a small business or a nonprofit. There's a big difference in allotting for an individual to be able to appeal a particular decision in the ordinance with all my concerns.
Kind of like the idea of the bureau committee. Chamber and all that.
That's a great idea. All those volunteers want to get involved.
Give some direction. Is there any other public comment? Okay. Public comments closed. Back to us for direction to hold up.
I like the idea of the mural committee myself.
I do too.
And that's going to cut costing and it's going to.
Community involvement. You said you'd recruit volunteers to help?
We'd like the city attorney.
That's such a good idea.
Council, a committee would be fine, and if the chamber wants to do it, that's fine. If you're talking a council committee or the council's getting involved in this decision, then obviously that requires an ordinance. And I would like to remind council that you still have an ordinance on the books that you have to do.
So, that's even if I may, real quick, I guess we'd have to ask that would be part of the. For the city manager and staff to find out if the chamber would even want to do this. So
in the interim, though, there was a request made to go through with their mural ask without charging a fee till we get the ordinance and everything caught up to it. So can we proceed with that?
Do that with our existing ordinance and just say we're going to do it?
Yeah, you're not waiving the fee. You are deferring the fee until you finish the process.
So we're going to defer the process and the fee.
Yeah.
And we're going to approve them going forth with their mural.
You're deferring the process that are on the books with the idea that staff will bring back a new ordinance and start that process, because that process to bring forward a new ordinance is several months long.
Yes.
Really, we're following staff's recommendation on this, because that is your recommendation, right?
Yes, that's correct.
And we do, this is, we have to make sure that we do have an intent to change the ordinance in the future, though.
That's what is required by the motion.
Do we have a motion for that?
So I'll make the motion that we temporarily postpone those fees or defer those fees until we finalize our new ordinance outcome. And in the interim, we'll be moving towards fixing that ordinance situation.
Second.
And allowing the ceremony
to come forward within the next few months so this gets
absolutely
shut down.
All of that.
Can you write that all down?
It's all recorded.
Okay.
Okay, so then a motion by Ms. Blair and a second by Mr. Brown, correct? Okay, Ms. Blair?
Aye.
Mr. Brown?
Aye.
Chester?
Aye.
Neil?
Aye.
And I vote aye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Move to city council reports and requests, Ms. Blair.
I will try to talk quickly, I promise. I know everybody's tired. Thank you, everybody who's come. I think this is the largest council meeting we've had in some time, so that's awesome. So my reports and recommendations, first, I wanted to take note of the Hamburg Ramona Road cleanup, all of the brush and debris that was done. It looks phenomenal. It is like night and day across Hamburg Ramona Road right now, driving past there. I know there's still some cleanup to do, but just the brushes and the grass there, fantastic. So great job on that. And I really like that we've got some new hires in-house doing that. My recommendations, one is us streaming. My first recommendation when it comes to technology is looking into a YouTube channel. You can still take the YouTube videos and put them up on Facebook, but by doing a channel, which is what a lot of other councils do, you can also then put that on our website directly and directly embed it into a page as we're updating our website. So I just wanted to make that a recommendation. I also wanted to recommend, and I've talked to Nathan about this briefly already, but I wanted to bring it up on the dais, the idea of a public transit type system, a light rail trolley system. And I know that sounds a little ridiculous at first, but it would alleviate, if we could have paths that would go around schools, it could alleviate a lot of traffic density, particularly over by that circle by West Hills in the morning at 8 o'clock, for example, or by Liberty, or by Cinnamon, and we know there's a lot of traffic issues. In doing so, we are in an air quality control district. We could look for grant money to do so. And additionally, we might need, if we needed more public safety officers, for example, perhaps they could be in line with something like that. So I don't know how fast we'll want to move on something like that, but that is a recommendation I had. And lastly, I spoke to Amy over at the chamber briefly about an idea, and together we sort of had an idea of a game, if you will. Perhaps this is something our youth advisory council can work on, but the idea of a scavenger hunt. Some of the larger cities have scavenger hunts you can pay for, you join with friends, and you can go out. When talking to the chamber, one of the ideas that came out of that, how do we incorporate that with our small businesses? The idea of perhaps having a game, maybe out of Parks and Rec, for example, where they can go to certain businesses that we've maybe spoken to that would like to offer. For example, go to this business and get an ice cream cone on Wednesdays for, you know, $1.50 or something. This business, 10% off a shoe shine, whatever it is, but along the way, it's a scavenger hunt of sorts, and how that would be composed is anyone's guess, but it did seem like something that might go along with our youth advisory council, some project that they might be interested in working on, and it kind of works hand in hand with the city providing an activity that's family-friendly, gets people downtown perhaps, and something that's affordable for our families to do together, because a lot of times it's all about finding activities that families can do and participate in that don't cost an arm and a leg. And so those are my recommendations.
Thank you.
Ron? Just want to thank Laprino for their donations that they've been giving recently. The recent one to the Lemoore Police Department, trauma kits, that's big. All of our nonprofits in the city of Lemoore, we have a lot of many hands make light work, and we have a lot of people out there to give back to the city. There's quite a few Lions and Rotary and Unity. So, and those people, you know, we had people in here today, volunteer fire department. They give back to the city. That's what Lemoore's about. So I want to thank everybody for doing that. You know, please bring your suggestions, comments, what you want to see in your city, bring it to us. That's what we need. We need to get feedback. Good, bad, happy, sad, let us know. That's all I have. Thank you to staff. You're doing a great job. You're doing a great job. Thank you.
Thank you. Chester?
No report. Just get well soon.
Yeah. Just wanted to remind everyone that we do have the Lemoore Chamber of Commerce, Citizen of the Year.